But anyways, right. So from today, we'll be discussing a topic of neoplasia, and we'll be discussing different types of tumors. We'll be discussing how the nomenclature is done for the benign tumors, how the nomenclature is done for the malignant tumors. At the same time, we'll also be discussing, first of all, how these tumors spread. Okay, how do these tumors undergo metastasis from one position or from one place to another place? And thirdly, at the last, we'll be discussing the characters of a tumor. If a cell has to be called as a metastatic cell or a neoplastic cell, so what are the characters it should have? We'll be discussing that. And at the end, we'll be doing croc MCQs. Clear? But anyways, what is neoplasia? Tell me. Neo means new. Plasia is growth. So you need to add some more things to this. What can you add? Very good. Uncontrolled growth and see, for example, look, if I take a normal cell, right? If I take a normal cell like this. Now, to this normal cell, for example, if I add, let us say, some growth factors. Okay? If I add some growth factors to this normal cell, will this cell divide or no? Yes, obviously, this cell will divide. Now, to this cell, again, if I add some more growth factors, again, this cell will multiply. Yes or no? But if I stop adding growth factors, if I don't add any growth factors, will the cell multiply? No. So, this is the character of a normal cell. This is the characteristic of a normal cell. Right? Next thing. If I take a tumor cell, this is a tumor cell. Now, when I add growth factor to this cell, obviously this tumor cell will divide, right? Okay, let us say this is a neoplastic cell. Now, when I add again a growth factor, again it will divide. But now, if I don't add any growth factor, will it divide? Yes. It will divide, okay? So, what is neoplasia? Neoplasia is nothing but uncontrollable. Okay, by the way, this type of growth, is it a controllable growth or uncontrollable growth? Uncontrollable growth even in the absence of a growth factor. Okay, neoplasia, what is the definition of neoplasia? Neoplasia is characterized by uncontrolled growth of the cells even in the absence of a growth factor. Clear? Another example which I can give to you is, see here, for example, this is my skin. Let us say this is the skin of my hand. Okay, now, for example, this part of the skin has been damaged. When this part of the skin has been damaged, what will happen is, these are the cells that are surrounding the skin. Yes or no? These are the cells that are surrounding the skin. These are the healthy cells. Now, what will happen? Now, what will happen? You tell me. See, these surrounding healthy cells, what will they do is, they will release growth factors into this. They will release growth factors. So, the moment growth factors are released into this, obviously, what will happen? Cell will undergo division, proliferation, right? So the cells, they divide. So these cells, they divide. They'll divide till they have compensated the lost cells. Previously, that part where it was broken, the cells were lost. So till it compensates those lost cells, these cells, they keep on dividing. Okay? Why they stop is, the moment they compensate the lost cells, the adjacent cells, they stop releasing the growth factors. So, when the adjacent cells stop releasing the growth factors, as it is a normal tissue, they don't divide. Now, compare and contrast it with a malignant cell or a neoplastic cell. Now, these are the cells in the body and these are the cells, and here this part of my tissue has been injured. Let us tell that one of the healthy cell is undergoing a neoplastic transformation. Now, what will happen is, to compensate these lost cells, what will happen? The healthy cells, they release, including the tumor cell, all of them, or the neoplastic cell, they release growth factors. Now, when the growth factor is released, what is happening? Obviously, the number of cells are increased. So, these cells, they increase, and they don't stop after their compensation. even after they have compensated the lost cells, even then these cells, they keep on increasing, they keep on dividing, they keep on increasing, 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 and finally they will form a solid mass here. This solid mass is called as a tumor. Now, if I have to differentiate between what is a neoplasm and what is a tumor, is neoplasia is the process of cell division. The uncontrollable process of cell division is called neoplasia. As a result of neoplasia, what I have got? A solid mass. This is called as tumor. So this is the difference between neoplasia and tumor. But anyways, neoplasia or tumor, is both of them, they are same. Okay, you are clear with this, right? Now, generally, when we discuss about a neoplasia, or when we discuss about a tumor, what contents does the tumor have generally? See, for example, this is a tissue in my body, right? This is a tissue. Now, tissue has a lot of collagen fibers. There are a lot of collagen fibers here. Yes or no? There is excessive deposition of, I am talking about the normal tissue now. There are a lot of collagen fibers. In addition to these collagen fibers, what else I have? I also have, very good, blood vessels, capillaries and everything like this. Blood vessels also I have. Yes or no? So in addition to this, I will have fibrocytes, fibroblasts and all of such things, right? Now, adding upon that, I also have the normal cells in my body. So the normal cells, and on the background, I have that all the connective tissue and the blood vessels, right? So this entire thing is called as a tissue. Clear? Now, within this tissue, if I'm strictly speaking, only about these cells here, only this cellular component of the tissue, these cells, they constitute parenchyme. Only the cells within the tissue, they are called as parenchyme. What is parenchyma? Parenchyma is nothing but the cells which are forming the tissue. Clear? Okay, if I remove the cells, what is the leftover part? Tell me. I have the connective tissue part. I have the blood vessels. I have the connective tissue and blood vessels. So these together you call it as stroma. Yes or no? All of these you call it as stroma. This is generally located in a normal tissue. Right? This is a representation of a normal tissue. Let us say, for example, see this cell, this particular cell is undergoing a neoplastic transformation. When this particular cell is undergoing a neoplastic transformation, what will happen? The cell divides. It divides profusely like this. Yes or no? So it divides, 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 divides. Is the connective tissue dividing or just the parenchymal cells are dividing? Parenchymal cells are dividing. So there will be increased parenchymal tissue. Yes or no? There is increased parenchymal tissue. So there is, as a result of this increased parenchymal tissue, what is happening? There are parenchymal tumors formed. Parenchymal tumors that are formed. You are understanding, right? There are parenchymal tumors that are formed. Now, how do I differentiate is, when you palpate these parenchymal tumors, they are generally soft. Parenchymal, remember, parenchymal tumors are always soft and fleshy, because parenchymal tumor, the word itself says that only there is increase in number of the parenchymal cells, not the stroma. Okay? Okay, now let us discuss another thing. Another thing is, see, these are the parenchymal cells. The left hand represents the parenchymal cells. These are the stromal cells, the stromal connective tissue. What did I tell you previously? The number of the parenchymal tissue is very high. I mean, the parenchymal cells are more. That time the tumor was formed. That was spongy and fleshy. Now, parenchymal cells are normal, but the stromal connective tissue is more. I mean, what I mean by that is, there is a lot of collagen deposition. There are a lot of blood vessels that are perfusing here. There are a lot of fibroblasts which keep on synthesizing collagen. There is a lot of connective tissue component. So there is increase in the level of stroma now. When there is increase in level of stroma, also there will be a formation of tumor there. But these tumors are called as stromal tumors. Yes or no? How does these tumors look? They look hard and firm. Okay? These tumors are generally hard. hard or firm tumors. Why it is hard, tell me? Because of excessive collagen deposition, right? So generally, when we look at the tumors, tumors can generally be classified into parenchymal tumors or the connective tissue tumors. Okay, parenchymal tumors are generally soft because only parenchymal cells are increased. Connective tissue tumors are hard because only the connective tissue component or the stromal component is increased. Okay, as there is a lot of collagen in that connective tissue component, so they are hard basically. Shall I go for the next? Any confusion so far? No. Now, another important thing is there are some conditions. What happens is, see, for example, I'm drawing a few neoplastic cells here. Clear? Now, these cells are profusely dividing. They're increasing in number. It means I should tell that the parenchymal cells are increasing in number. So when the parenchymal cells are increasing in number, sometimes it might happen like this, that these parenchymal cells, they release growth factors. These parenchymal cells itself release growth factors. And what does these growth factors do? These growth factors in turn cause the growth of the stroma. You're getting it? So this is a neoplastic cell. These are neoplastic cells. They are releasing growth factors. And these growth factors are causing increase in growth of stroma. Now, when you consider this tissue, what is there in this tissue? There is high level of parenchymatous tissue. At the same time, there is high level of stromal connective tissue. So both of them are increased. Yes or no? How they are increased? Parenchymal cells, first they are increased. They multiplied and they release growth factors. And with these growth factors, in turn cause the increase of stromal connective tissue. So such type of division, this is called as desmoplasia. Okay, such type of division you name it as desmoplasia. What does desmoplasia stand? Desmoplasia is increase in both the parenchymatous tissue, at the same time the stromal connective tissue, right? So where do I find such desmoplasia taking place in my body? I mean, not under normal conditions, obviously. If I have desmoplasia, then most commonly what organs are involved in desmoplasia? Stomach. Most commonly stomach is involved. And breast. Stomach and breast, both of them are involved. See, for example, I take the stomach like this here, right? Generally, how does this desmoplasia affects the stomach is, look, within this stomach, there is diffuse proliferation, or there is diffuse spread of the tumor within the stomach. So this desmoplasia spreads diffusely into the stomach. When it spreads diffusely in the stomach, what will happen in the stomach? The number of gastric cells are increased or no? Because desmoplasia itself is increase in number of parenchymatous cells. So the parenchymatous cells in the stomach are increased. At the same time, the connective tissue in the stomach, the gastric mucosal connective tissue in the stomach is also increased. Yes or no? So when both of them are increased, will the stomach wall look thin or thick? Thick. At times, it might also happen like this, that this desmoplasia might progress so severely that the stomach completely shrinks down. Okay? Stomach completely shrinks down. So this type of stomach is called as linitis plastica or leather bottle appearance of the stomach. You are clear with this? You understood? This is called as linitis plastica or the leather bottle appearance of the stomach. Clear? Thirdly, there might be some conditions where, see, previously I told you that either parenchymatous cells might be increased or the stromal connective tissue will be increased, right? If stromal connective tissue is increased, the tumors look how? Hard and firm, right? In some tumors are so specialized that the stromal connective tissue content is increased so severely that there is a lot of collagen deposition. And what happens when there is a lot and lot of collagen deposition is lot and lot of calcium also binds to this collagen. So when you palpate the tumor not doesn't look firm, but it looks stony hard. Okay, the tumor looks stony hard. Why the tumor looks stony hard? Because of excessive collagen plus calcium. So such tumors are called as Skirrus tumors. Skirrus tumors. Okay. Such tumors are called as Skirrus tumors. Now, having said that, another important thing is, see, if you don't, these neoplastic cells, when you don't add any growth factor, even then these neoplastic cells divide. What is causing these neoplastic cells to divide when there is no growth factor? Very good. Genes. You're right. Genes. Right? So, exactly what happens to these genes? Mutation. Very good. There might be some mutations. So, basically when I talk about a normal cell, this is a normal cell. Normal cell has DNA in it. For example, if I uncoil the DNA, this is a DNA in a normal cell. Now, when I uncoil the DNA, what do I find is, look here. Here, I have some set of genes on this DNA. Some set of genes on this DNA. Let us say these set of genes are called as A, these are called as B, these are called as C, D, and E. Okay? There are some set of genes. For example, if I activate these group of genes, then this cell will divide into two cells. Okay? It means these genes are favoring cell division, multiplication, right? Next, if I activate these group of genes, the B group of genes, what will happen is the cell division stops. It means this single cell remains as a single cell. It does not divide. Okay? Next, if I activate these group of genes, what will happen is, look here, if I activate these group of genes, what is going to happen is the cell will commit suicide. Cell committing suicide is called apoptosis, right? So if I activate these group of genes, the cell will commit suicide, which is called as apoptosis. Then if I activate these group of genes, the cell will not commit suicide. It means the lifespan of the cell is increased or decreased? Increased. But the later one, the lifespan of the cell is decreased. So these group of genes upon activation, when there is cell division, so these group of genes are called as proto-onco genes. Okay. The second set of genes, when I activate them, the cell division doesn't happen. There is a cessation of the cell division. So these are called as tumor suppressor genes. And the third group of cells are called as pro-apoptotic genes, which perform the cell suicide or a cell death, programmed cell death. The second group of genes are called as anti-apoptotic genes. So our normal body, our normal cell is always programmed with the help of these genes. When it has to divide, when it shouldn't divide, when it has to die and when it shouldn't die, everything is programmed with these genes. Okay? If there is any mutation of these genes, this will result in related conditions. For example, we are discussing about the topic about the neoplasia. See here, everyone. For example, there might be some mutations where the mutations might happen in such a way that these proto-oncogenes should be hyperactivated. You're understanding what I'm telling? There might be some mutations to these proto-oncogenes in such a way that these proto-oncogenes have to be hyperactivated. When these proto-oncogenes are hyperstimulated or hyperactivated, then the cell will divide, multiply, or it doesn't multiply. Of course, the cell will divide, it will differentiate. You're getting it? There might be some other conditions, there might be some other mutations of these tumor suppressor genes in such a way that these tumor suppressor genes have to be underactivated. So when tumor suppressor genes are underactivated, will the cell divide or no? Why no? It will divide. Because the function of tumor suppressor gene is to suppress the division. When I'm removing this gene, is there any gene to suppress the division? No. Obviously, this will take its upper hand. You're getting it. So there are two main reasons why, even though when you don't add a growth factor, the cell is dividing. The reason behind that is mutations. Exactly speaking, what mutations are? Hyperactivity mutations, or mutations in such a way that proto-oncogenes are hyperactivated, mutations in such a way that tumor suppressor genes are underactivated. So these are the main two reasons for formation of a malignant cell or a neoplastic cell. You're clear so far, everyone? Now, when we discuss about the next two genes, that is pro-apoptotic genes and anti-apoptotic genes. But before that, let me give you a list of proto-oncogenes and tumor suppressor genes. What are the list of proto-oncogenes which you have? Tell me. Proto-oncogenes. The list of proto-oncogenes. For example, there is a gene called as HER2. Okay? For example, if I activate this gene, what will happen is it will result in the formation of breast cancer. Result in the formation of a breast malignum, breast cancer. Next, another set of gene is called as BRAF gene. BRAF gene. If I activate this gene, it will result in the formation of a melanoma. You know what is melanoma, right? Tumor of melanocytes. And the third gene is CRAS gene. If I activate this gene, I'll end up having esophageal cancer and colon cancer. Esophageal or colon cancers. So these are the most three important proto-oncogenes which you need to remember. There are many more, but these three are most important because esophageal cancers, colon cancers, breast cancers, melanomas are most common. So you have to remember the genes that are causing them. Clear? Right. Let us discuss the list of tumor suppressor genes. Tumor suppressor genes. The first gene is NF1. NF1 gene. The next gene is WT1. And the last one is RB1. NF1 stands for neurofibromatosis. Neurofibromatosis. You heard of that neurofibromatosis? You haven't seen a picture of neurofibromatosis? You have seen a picture on Facebook. This picture looks like there are multiple nodules that are formed on the entire body. So this condition is neurofibromatosis. Okay? WT1 is nothing but called as Wilms tumor. Wilms tumor or nephroblastoma. Wilms tumor. What is this Wilms tumor? Wilms tumor is generally seen in age group 3 to 4 years. Kids who are under the age group of 3 to 4 years. Okay? So there will be unilateral swelling of the kidney, and you can feel the palpation here, but patient won't have any pain. So what is the treatment which you give? Is you have to resect the kidney. Okay, that is called as Wilms tumor. So most commonly found under 3 to 4 years of age. RB1 is retinoblastoma. So if you are activating these proto-oncogenes, it will result in these conditions. If you are mutating these tumor suppressor genes, it will result in these conditions. You're clear so far, right? Coming to the pro-apoptotic genes and the anti-apoptotic genes. So first of all, let me discuss what are the list of pro-apoptotic genes. And later I will tell you the mechanisms. So what are the list of pro-apoptotic genes? Tell me. Very good. Tell me. BAX gene,
and
P53 gene. You heard of P53, right? BAX gene, BAX gene, and P53 gene, you have heard of it, I think. Next, another gene is BCL excess gene. You have to remember this anyhow. Okay? You have to remember these genes.
BCL gene is anti-apoptotic.
No, no. BCL excess is?
BCL2 is anti-apoptotic.
Pro-apoptotic gene. Okay? Next group of genes are anti-apoptotic genes. Anti-apoptotic genes are, one is BCL2 gene, BCLXL gene. Okay, remember like this that BCLXS, S starts for stimulation, right? So there will be apoptosis. L starts for limitation, so there will be no apoptosis. Okay, so having said that, you have to memorize this anyhow. Only 3 are there, right? So just memorize it. Now, basically, there are generally two pathways of apoptosis. One is called as intrinsic pathway, and another one is called as extrinsic pathway. Now, when we discuss about the intrinsic pathway of apoptosis, within this intrinsic pathway, look here. Everyone, however the video will be recorded, you can write later on, because if you keep on writing, the time will go till 10. So that's why don't write, because we have a lot of topics to discuss after this. Okay, so generally within the cell you have mitochondria, right? Within the cell you have mitochondria, and within mitochondria what do you have? You have many more things within the mitochondria, but one of that is cytochrome C. Clear? Now, if something has to go out of mitochondria, something has to enter into the mitochondria, you need ion channels or no? So, there is an ion channel, for example. There are multiple ion channels anyways. There are multiple ion channels. Now, one important thing which I want to tell you is, if you bring this cytochrome C out of the cell, cell will undergo apoptosis. So, now the condition which I am giving to you is, you should not let the cytochrome C to go out of the cell. Then what you should do? You have to guard these ions with some proteins here, with some genes here. You have to guard these ions with some genes, right? So, for that, what type of genes do you use? Pro-apoptotic genes or anti-apoptotic? Very good, anti-apoptotic. Because if I use pro-apoptotic, cytochrome C will come out and there will be cell death. So, I have to use anti-apoptotic gene. For example, the anti-apoptotic gene which I am choosing is BCL2 gene, right? Now, if this BCL2 gene has to function well, then you have to provide this BCL2 gene with growth factors. Okay? If you provide this BCL2 gene with growth factors, then this BCL2 gene will work properly and it will guard this ion channel so that cytochrome C, it will make sure that cytochrome C doesn't come out. For example, if you don't provide growth factors to a cell, when you don't provide growth factors, then what will happen? Will the BCL2 gene work? No. When BCL2 gene doesn't work, will it be attached here? No. So what will happen is, this BCL2 gene will detach and it will fall down. When there is no growth factor, the BCL2 gene will detach and fall down. The moment BCL2 gene comes out, there are another set of genes which are waiting to go and attach to these ion channels. So, those set of genes which will attach to these ion channels are back genes. Clear? What will happen when back gene will attach? Back gene is an apoptotic gene. It means, some or the other way, back gene will try to bring the cytochrome Z out of the cell and cause apoptosis. So, when back gene is attached here, of course, there are thousands and thousands of channels. So, everywhere the back genes will be attached. So, when the back genes will be attached, the permeability of the mitochondria is increased. When the permeability of mitochondria is increased, what will happen? The cytochrome Z moves out of the cell. You're getting it. So, the moment cytochrome Z comes out of the cell, what will happen? Of course, there is increase in concentration of cytochrome C. When there is increase in concentration of cytochrome C, this cytochrome C will activate another set of proteins called as apoptotic, AP stands for apoptotic, activation factor number 1. apoptotic activation factor number 1, right? APAFN stands for apoptotic activation factor number 1. Now what will happen is, this apoptotic activation factor number 1, what it will do is, this will activate caspase protein, caspase 9 and caspase 10, okay? It will activate another set of proteins called as caspase 9 and caspase 10. And this caspase 9 and caspase 10 will in turn activate caspase 3, 6 and 7. Okay? Is it difficult? Life is only difficult. What is this? It will activate caspase 3, 6 and 7. So when caspase 3, 6 and 7 are activated, okay, you tell me, generally we have two different types of enzymes. For example, we have enzymes called as proteases. We also have enzymes called as endonucleases. For example, if I take a tissue in my hand, I add proteases. When I add proteases, all the proteins which are located in the tissue are broken down. Second thing, when I add endonucleases, what will happen? These endonucleases will enter into the nucleus and damage the DNA. So when the proteins are broken down, when the DNA is damaged, will the cell survive? The cell will die. So what caspase 367 is doing is, this caspase 367 will in turn activate two enzymes. One is protease, another one is endonuclease. Clear? You are understanding? Is there any external factor that is getting into the cell and damaging the cell? No. The genes within the cell, the proteins within the cell, the internal environment itself is causing the damage of the cell. You are clear with that? So this is the intrinsic pathway. The most important questions which are asked from this intrinsic pathway are, what is the initiator molecule? What is the executional molecule? See, caspase 9 and 10, caspase 9 and 10 are called as initiator molecules. Okay, keep in mind. Caspase 9 and 10, both of them are called as initiator molecules of intrinsic pathway. And caspase 3, 6, 7 are called as executional molecules. Executional molecules of the intrinsic pathway. You are clear with this? Everyone? So we are done with the discussion of proto-onco, tumor suppressor. In pro-apoptotic genes, we have to discuss two things. One is the intrinsic pathway, another one is the extrinsic pathway. Right? Now coming to the extrinsic pathway, what is extrinsic pathway is, this is a cell, right? This is a cell. On the surface of the cell, you have some specific proteins called as ligands. These are called as ligands, right? What is the name of these ligands? Very good. These ligands are called as FAS ligands. Other name for this is tumor necrosis factor ligand, TNF ligand. Okay? Clear, everyone? Next, on the surface of these ligands, you have receptors. These receptors are called as, of course, these receptors also will be called as FAS receptors or TNF receptors. Okay? And down below in the cytoplasmic environment, here you will have ligands. These are the domains, not the ligands. These are called as domains. What is the name of these domains is FAS domains. FAS DD. DD stands for death domain. FAS death domain. Okay? Now generally what happens is, in this extrinsic pathway, what happens is, see, generally TNF molecules, these TNF molecules, they come and attach to this TNF receptors. Okay? The moment TNF molecules comes and attach to these TNF receptors, what will happen is, these three ligands are activated. The moment these three ligands are activated, these three domains, the FAS death domains, they both of them join together. Okay? These FAS domains, all these FAS domains, they all of them, they join together. So this process of joining of all these FAS domains is called as trimerization. Trimerization. So what will happen as a result of trimerization? When there is trimerization, this trimerized molecules will give some input into the cell. What is that input?
that input converts procaspase 8 molecule to caspase 8. Okay? This caspase 8 later on activates caspase 3, caspase 6, caspase 7. Now you know what will happen when caspase 3, 6, 7 are activated. It will in turn activate proteases, endonuclease and cause cell death. Now the important thing which you need to know is, what is the initiator molecule here? The initiator molecule is caspase 8. Executional molecule is caspase 3, 6 and 7. So this is the difference between intrinsic pathway and extrinsic pathway. In intrinsic pathway, the initiator molecule is different. In extrinsic pathway, the initiator molecule is different. Here 9 and 10, here 8. But the executional molecule on both of them are the same. Shall I rub this intrinsic pathway? Right. Now, having said the basic, we'll enter into the tumors. Generally, now you know what is neoplasia and what is tumor. Neoplasia is a process and tumor is the result. Now, tumors are generally of two different types. Okay? Tumors are generally two different types. Some are called as benign tumors, some are called as malignant tumors. What are benign tumors? Tell me. Benign tumors are fast growing tumors or slow growing tumors? Benign tumors are always slow growing tumors. So slow growth. Whereas malignant tumors are fast growth. Now, what will happen is, listen, what will happen is, everyone listen now, what will happen is, as these benign tumors are slowly growing, right, as these benign tumors are slowly growing, the surrounding healthy tissue takes time and slowly it forms a capsule around that, okay? But whereas malignant tumors, as they are going very fastly, the surrounding healthy tissue, you haven't provided sufficient time for the surrounding healthy tissue to form a capsule around it. Because by the time it is forming a capsule, the cells are keeping on proliferating. So that is the reason why malignant tumors, they don't have a capsule, and benign tumors, they have a capsule around them. You're clear? So if I draw the benign cell, see, these are benign cells here. These are the benign cells, and these benign cells are surrounded by a capsule. But when I come over these malignant cells here, these malignant cells are not covered with any capsule. So that is the reason why malignant cells detach from one another and they undergo metastasis and go to different places and settle there and form secondary tumors there. This is a primary tumor. Some cells detach from the primary tumor, they undergo metastasis, go to some other organs and form secondary tumors there. So when you compare and contrast, which is more dangerous, benign or malignant? Malignant. If I had to do a surgery, which is easy to remove, benign or malignant? Benign tumors are easy to remove. And one important thing is, what if I remove a capsule around this benign tumor? See, basically, all these malignant tumors are in a cluster, right? Why these malignant tumors are metastasizing to different areas, tell me? Of course, there is no capsule. Okay, reason number one is there is no capsule, right? Reason number one, there is no capsule. So when there is no capsule, of course, these cells might detach from one another and they go to distant places. What is reason number two? Fast growth is it will grow it in its space. Why will it go somewhere and grow?
No more space.
Another thing is,
Second reason is the adherence between these two molecules is very less. Okay? The adherence or the attachment between two tumor cells is very less. So when the attachment between two tumor cells is very less, then of course they will detach.
So decreased adherence.
And third important thing, what is the third important thing? Previously I told you in desmoplasia, what did I tell you? Tumor cells have a capacity to release growth factors.
So these tumor cells, for example, this is my liver here, right? Here I have a set of tumor cells. Clear?
Now these tumor cells will release what? Growth factor. The growth factor which it is releasing is what? Vascular endothelial growth factor.
Okay? The growth factor which it releases is vascular endothelial growth factor. What is this vascular endothelial growth factor is?
This growth factor is responsible for the formation of minute blood vessels. Okay? Very small blood vessels.
So these growth factor is responsible for the formation of very, very, very small blood vessels.
So when it forms such very small blood vessels, what will happen is these tumor cells can easily migrate through these blood vessels and then enter into the liver and settle here. You are understanding? Is everyone clear? Right? Clear or no? Right. The next important thing, what is the fourth important reason? Tell me. What is the fourth important cause of why these malignant cells, they undergo metastasis to different areas?
Okay, well, let us talk within the liver itself. For example, the malignant tumor is here, right? Now, this tumor has to go here. Of course, it will go. This tumor went to this part. Now, how did it go there?
We already discussed through blood vessels. What is another mechanism through which a tumor can move from one place to another place?
No. See, basically, for example, when I take this as a tissue, in the tissue, you have a lot of fibers and collagen and all. Yes or no? For example, here I have got a malignant tumor. Okay? Now, this malignant tumor cannot pass because all these fibers, all this collagen and the connective tissue is restricting the movement of this malignant tumor. So, what malignant tumors they do is not only vascular endothelial growth factor, but these malignant tumors also release an enzyme called as collagenase. Collagenase. What is the function of collagenase? It will destroy all the collagen fibers. When it will destroy all the collagen fibers, the matrix becomes very loose. So when the matrix becomes very loose, it will be easy for this tumor cell to metastasize to different area. You are getting it? So fourth important reason is secretion of collagenase. Not only collagenase, there is also one more thing which is secreted. Can anyone tell? Secretion of collagenase and stromyelin. Stromyelinase. Stromyelinase is responsible for the destruction of stroma. Okay? Stromyelinase is responsible for the destruction of the stroma. Okay? Clear? You understood this? Everyone? You wrote this? Very good. Now, let us go back to our discussion between the differences between the malignant cell, the benign cell as well as the malignant cell. Now, coming to the benign cell, so here you have a capsule, here you don't have a capsule. Next, for example, this is a benign cell, okay? If this benign cell divides, everyone, if this cell divides, what will happen is there are many daughter cells that are formed. Yes or no? Now, these daughter cells are resembling the parent cell. They both are resembling to each other. So, such type of differentiation is called as well differentiation. Okay? So benign tumors have a character of well differentiation. But when you compare and contrast to the malignant cell, see here, this is a malignant cell. Now when it starts to divide, everyone, this malignant cell, when it starts to divide, the daughter cells, they are like this. Okay? Now, are the daughter cells resembling the parent cell? No. Then should I call it as well differentiation or poor differentiation? So malignant cells are poorly differentiated. Malignant cells are